Tandem OLED. Freaking awesome, right? Wait, hold the phone. Tandem OLED? What the what? So Apple geniuses just smashed together two OLED panels and et voila, a brand new, unprecedentedly awesome new display is born, exclusive to the new iPad Pro? Well, not exactly. There's more to it than that. But in the end, it is great news for all of us. Stick around, let's talk about it. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Caleb Dennison, and I'm presently on assignment in New York. That's why with the hotel room shoot. I've been busy looking at and testing next-gen TVs from Hisense and TCL. In fact, I first heard about Tandem OLED from a fellow journalist and friend, Jaron Schneider at Petapixel, who texted me, please do a video on how QD OLED and Tandem OLED differ and what makes each special. To which I replied, Tandem what? I mean, I'm a TV expert, which doesn't necessarily mean I'm a display expert, but you know, maybe display expert adjacent. I spent a lot of time on the bleeding edge of display technology, especially anything involving OLED. So imagine my surprise when Jaron and then a host of others started texting me questions about Apple's new Tandem OLED. Honestly, I knew nothing about it. So I immediately began looking into it, starting with Apple's own description. Basically, they said, we developed a state-of-the-art display that uses two OLED panels and combines the light from both to deliver phenomenal full screen brightness. No other device of its kind delivers this level of display quality. And then they go on to explain all the benefits inherent to OLED display tech and announce it as Ultra Retina XDR. So, brass tacks, what makes the promised performance of this screen so remarkable is its high brightness. 1000 nits full screen and 1600 nits peak brightness for HDR highlights. That is awesome indeed, but is it the best OLED display you can get in a consumer device? And how in the world does using two OLED panels work? Is it an OLED sandwich of sort? And did Apple really invent this? Well, to better understand Tandem OLED technology, let's start at its beginning, which did not take place in an Apple laboratory. I found this white paper, which was submitted in 2009 as part of the Society for Information Display, or SID, Display Week Symposium. That's an inside industry trade show for the latest in display tech. Tandem OLED, or the concept of it at least, was developed 15 years ago, folks, about 2 years before LG introduced the first consumer OLED TV. Since then, numerous developments have been made to make it more efficient, and several more white papers have been issued talking about its advancement into a now fully baked technology. So, if the tech has been around for so long, why haven't we seen Tandem OLED in a device before? Well, let's actually come back to that. First, let's talk about the two most popular types of OLED panels at use in devices today. One is called WOLED or WRGB OLED, also sometimes referred to as white OLED. This is a panel that uses organic compounds to make red, green, and blue pixels that make their own light. No backlight needed. Then a white OLED subpixel is added to boost up the brightness. LG Display has pioneered this technology, and for years, it was the only kind of OLED panel that you would find in TVs and PC monitors. Then, a couple of years ago, Samsung Display came out with a new type of OLED panel called QD OLED. And this just uses a blue OLED pixel to create light, then adds red and green quantum dots, which are tiny little nanoparticles that glow when you shine light on them. Now, QD OLED panels make more pure red, green, and blue light than WOLED panels, so they tend to have better color brightness and color purity. Now, overall, the advantages of either OLED tech are as Apple described. Perfect black levels, amazing contrast, incredible pixel response time, and rich, accurate color. Year after year, OLED TVs are named as having the best picture quality that you can buy. So, if OLED is so awesome, why isn't it used in everything? Well, it's because OLED's Achilles heel is that it's an organic material. So it wears out faster the harder, or brighter, you drive it. That being the case, to protect OLED panels from burning out too soon, or burning in, TV manufacturers have had to cap how hard they drive them. Also, the bigger an OLED display is, the more power it gobbles up. And in a portable device like a tablet, that means it's gonna eat up the battery pretty quickly. So while an OLED display might work just fine in a phone, it's gonna be a bit too power hungry to work in a larger battery powered device like an iPad. Enter Tandem OLED. It is a WRGB OLED panel type, but it uses two light emitting layers, each driven with a relatively modest amount of power. So we're not gonna wear those OLED pixels out. And since there are two light emitting layers, that also makes Tandem OLED capable of getting extremely bright. All the brightness without all the drawbacks. Pretty genius. Now, one thing I cannot help demystify you because I don't understand it myself is how the light from one layer of this OLED sandwich passes through with the light of the second layer. For that information, I'm gonna have to chat with some display engineers familiar with this tech, and I'm already reaching out. So stay tuned for an update on that confusing detail. Now, if Tandem OLED is such a bright idea, sorry, why haven't we seen it in a device before? Why isn't it in TVs and PC monitors? Why haven't we seen it in a tablet before? Well, for a couple of reasons, I suspect. And I say I suspect because I need to verify this with a display engineer, and I'm reaching out to a bunch right now, like I said. But I think it's safe to conjecture that one, Tandem OLED is clearly fairly expensive to manufacture. If it wasn't, I'm pretty sure LG Display would be making them in sizes that we could put in TVs and PC monitors already. TVs can provide all the power that's needed, but these large size Tandem OLED panels are probably just too expensive to put in a TV. The second reason is that they need more power than mobile devices could deliver, at least until now. The batteries in a tablet or phone are gonna need to be pretty stout to support the processor and the display for any meaningful amount of time. And that, my friends, is where the massive power that Apple wields, paired with Apple's innovation, comes together to bring us the first Tandem OLED displays. Tandem OLED as a technology needed a cash-rich partner to push it into the real world. You don't make this sort of thing at a small scale. That's a surefire way to go bankrupt. You need to make display panels at a large scale, and making already expensive new panels at a large scale takes the kind of money very few organizations have. But Apple's got that money. But you also need a place to put this new panel technology, and an iPad is the perfect place to put something like an expensive new display. See, OLED panels start their life as a giant sheet of what's called mother glass. From this massive sheet of mother glass, you can cut any number of combinations of large and small displays. For example, you could cut out one 88-inch big screen and not have a whole lot left over, or you could cut out three 65-inch diagonal screens and still have enough left over to cut out six 32-inch diagonal screens. You can easily imagine then that the yield for something the size of an iPad Pro is going to be exponentially higher than it would be for something as big as a TV. Now, it's still expensive to make, but the yield is much higher, so Apple can recoup a good deal of its cost by building a healthy margin into each iPad, which apparently it has. The only problem that it seems only Apple could solve was the power issue. I believe that's where the M4 chip comes in. The M4 is such an efficient chip that Apple can afford to feed the Tandem OLED display what it needs to create that 1000 nits of full screen brightness and 1600 nits of peak HDR highlight brightness. But I suspect Apple probably did more than that. There were some low luminance efficiency issues Apple's resources likely helped to solve. And who knows what else Apple's mighty engineering muscle did to make putting a Tandem OLED screen into a device a reality. So while Apple may not have invented OLED, I think it's fair to credit Apple for getting Tandem OLED out of the lab at a display corporation and into a device. And I think we can also credit Apple for making the Tandem OLED screen what it is today. And now that it is in a consumer device, Well, let's just say it's a safe bet that Tandem OLED won't live exclusively in an iPad Pro for long. When folks get their eyes on the new Ultra Retina XDR, they are gonna want that kind of picture quality from every screen they have to look at. That demand will drive the innovation we need to see supply go up and costs go down. And trust me, you're about to get slapped in the face with a bunch of reviews talking about how incredible the new iPad Pro's Ultra Retina XDR display is. Because while there are TVs out now that can do 1600 nits peak HDR brightness, there isn't a consumer OLED on the market that can do 1000 nits sustained full screen brightness. There are, however, professional mastering displays at use in Hollywood that can deliver that kind of picture, and I've seen them. They are nothing short of stunning. So yeah, what Apple has done here is a really big deal. 1000 nits of average picture level means you can use the new iPad Pro in just about any environment, even outside. 1600 nits peak HDR brightness means that the iPad Pro is gonna match even the very best TVs on the market for picture quality. And knowing Apple, it might turn out to be the best looking consumer display on the market. I, for one, can't wait to get my hands on one. Thanks so much for watching, everyone. What did you think of this little explainer? Let me know down in the comment section below. Don't forget to like and subscribe. I'll see you on the next one. And until then, here's two other videos I think you might like.